I seem to be. Okay, so let me begin. So this talk is just an introduction to Plethysm. I don't assume you know anything about Plethysm at all. So what is Plethysm? It's a binary operation on symmetric functions. So you have two symmetric functions, f and g, and it takes this to f. I'll use McDonald's notation where he calls it f circle g, but a more common notation is f box g. But this f circle g notation is very suggestive. It explains the, it comes from the, you know, motivation for Plethysm. So the motivation for Plethysm comes from the representation theory of GLN, specifically the polynomial representation theory of GLN. So what is a polynomial representation? A polynomial representation of GLN is a homomorphism rho from GLN to GLM, which has the property that if you take rho G and you take its ijth entry for any ij, this is a polynomial in the entries of G. Okay, yeah, by the way, feel free to just interrupt me and ask any questions. There's no formality here. So I hope everything is clear. Okay, I'm assuming that everything is clear till now and that the audio and everything is fine. So this is the motivation, and once you have a polynomial representation, you can define its character. So character of rho is defined to be trace of rho applied to a diagonal matrix T1, T2, Tn. So this is going to be a symmetric polynomial in the variables T1, T2, Tn. Okay, just because if you permute these variables, the diagonal matrices are conjugate to each other. Okay, let me give you a couple of examples. So here's the simplest example, maybe is just take identity map from GLN to GLN. This is clearly a polynomial representation. The polynomial, the entry of identity GIJ is just GIJ, which is a polynomial of degree 1 in the entries of the matrix G. And its character is, identity of T1, T2, Tn is just T1 plus T2 plus Tn, which is a symmetric function in the n variables T1, T2, Tn. Let's do a slightly more interesting example. This example is based on the fact that the second symmetric power of C2 is isomorphic to C3. So this has a basis given by E1 squared, E1, E2, and E2 squared. And based, since SIM2 is functorial, this SIM2 C2 becomes a polynomial representation of GL2. So this representation is given by the following: X11, if you start with the matrix X11, X12, X21, X22, it's going to be the matrix X11 squared, 2X11, X21. I just worked this out in advance, X21 squared. It's not very difficult just using this basis. X11, X12, X11, X22 plus X12, X21, X21, x22, and in the third column we have x12 squared, 2x12, x22, and then x22 squared. Okay, something like this. So the exact form is not very important, but now notice that if you compute the trace of row of t1, t2, so we are putting 0 in these off diagonal places, then this will just give us t1 squared. Here, this x12 and x21 are 0, so here we'll just get t1, this is x22, t1, t2. And here we'll get t2 squared. So this is the complete symmetric polynomial of degree 2 in the variables t1 and
t2. Sir, how do you fill that matrix?
Okay, so I just asked, if I take x1, x11, x12, x21, x22 and apply it to the basis vector e1 squared, what happens? Okay, so let me just do the first column. So e1 goes to x11, e1 plus x21, e2, right? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so e1 squared will go to this thing squared.
Okay.
So if you expand that, then you'll get x11 squared times e1 squared plus x21 times e1 e2 plus x21 squared e2. Is that
Thank
clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So that's just, you know, what is it called? Multilinear algebra. Okay. So now where does plethysm come from? So the idea is this. Now you have representation GLn to GLm, and that is rho. But now I take another representation sigma from GLm to GLk. And the idea behind plethysm is that sigma circle rho is also a representation of GLn. Right? And let's compute its character. How does its character depend on the character of sigma and the character of rho? And that is the idea behind this plethysm operation. So it's character of sigma circle character of. So this is the motivation behind the definition of plethysm. So let's just see how we can try to, you know, make sense of this right hand side here. The left hand side is pretty clear. You compose two homomorphisms, you get a homomorphism, and then you compute its character. So now one feature of polynomial representations of GLn is that the image of diagonal matrices is itself diagonalizable. So what I'm saying is that CM, so if we talk about this representation rho here, then it's a representation of GLn on M dimensional vector space. So CM has a basis of eigenvectors.
Amri, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
I don't understand the composition notation on the right side.
Yeah, so that's the motivation. So that's what needs to be defined. And the motivation is that whatever it is, it should give the left-hand side.
So this is just notation for right now.
Yeah, so this is the motivation. So I just said that in the beginning that plethysm is a binary operation on symmetric functions. And where does it come from? It comes from composing polynomial representation. And so this equation here, this dot is
something you're going to define. This is a right-hand side dot.
Yeah. So this equation is sort of the motivating equation. We have to make sense of this to define plethysm. So I haven't really defined the right-hand side properly yet.
Can I say something and you can tell me if it's correct? So
please.
If you take two Weyl invariant functions on the torus, each of them determines a representation, compose the representations, and take the character. That is that more or less the
Yes. That's exactly what I'm trying to say.
Okay, okay.
Except so, that they could be virtual, right?
Yes.
Yeah, right.
So that's the problem. How do you compose virtual representation?
Okay, okay, okay. Fine.
So let's just go a little deeper into this and see what we need to do on an algebraic level. So we don't want to, construct the representations as such, but what does this do on an algebraic level? So we'll exploit the fact that CM has a basis of eigenvectors for, looks like I'm drawing squares here. For row of the diagonal t1 tn. So let's call that basis v1 v2 vn vm I guess, and row of t1, so being an eigenvector means really that this diagonal torus acts by an eigen character. So what it means is that this is of the form T1 raised to mu 1 Tn raised to mu n. But of course, this mu's is depend on which I. So I'll call it mu I1, mu In. So this is just a product. Okay, so this I'll define this as t to the power mu I. This mu I is a vector, an integer vector, whose entries are mu I1, mu I2, mu In, all non-negative integers. Okay, and this mu I is sometimes called a weight of the representation. So, and then what we have is that the character of rho is going to be the sum over all I. I goes from 1 to m in this case.
Amri, a trivial thing, but you are missing a vi in the previous line.
Oh, yeah, thanks. This times vi. Thank you. So the character is going to be sum of t raised to ui. So this is how we compute the character of a representation. We diagonalize it with respect to the torus. We find the weights, and then we just take a formal sum of the weights. Now, what we'll do is we'll write the matrices in GLM with respect to this basis. Okay, and now, so just remember we're looking at this situation, right? Maybe I'll copy this into the next page so that you can remember. Okay, so this is the situation we have. And CK likewise has a basis of eigenvectors for sigma of U1, U2, UM. So let's call this basis W1, W2. It'll have K elements here. And let's say that sigma of U1 UM of WJ is U raised to mu J. So this is a very analogous notation to before. This U is U1 raised to nu J1 U M raised to nu JM and times WJ. So then sigma circle rho of T1 dot 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 Tn. So what is rho of T1 dot 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 Tn? Well, we're writing this matrix with respect to the basis, diagonal basis, which we had chosen earlier, this V1, V2, Vn. So with respect to that, this rho of T1, T2, Tn is just T raised to mu 1 dot 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 T raised to mu k. Okay, so what we are doing is we have to compute the character of sigma, but instead of taking t1, t2, tk, we have to take t raised to mu1, t raised to mu cube, t raised to mu k. So what this is it's the character of sigma evaluated at.
Isn't it t raised to the mu to the m?
Mu to the. No, I think. Let's see. How many mu's are there? M. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, it's of course I copied this for a reason. Yeah, this is GLM, so this should be an M. You're absolutely right. This is a K by K matrix. Yeah. So this character of sigma, well, sigma is a representation of GLM, so this will have M variables, and you just substitute these monomials in place of those M variables. And one nice thing is that the order in which you put these monomials doesn't really matter, because sigma, character of sigma is symmetric. Okay, so this is a simple calculation in terms of weights of plethysm. Okay, so this only makes sense, of course, if when you're composing characters. But it makes sense in a slightly more general setting. So, so suppose G is a symmetric function of the form I goes from 1 to M X raised to mu I. So it doesn't have to come from a character or anything, but just let's suppose it is of this form.
Sir?
Yes, tell me.
What if the matrix is not diagonal matrices?
So these polynomial representations have the property that the image of the torus is always diagonalizable. So I've chosen the thing to be diagonal. Now, okay. If a matrix is not diagonal, what you can do is you can compute its eigenvalues and evaluate the same symmetric function on the eigenvalue.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, so the thing is, diagonalizable matrices form a dense subset of matrices and of GLM. And since everything here is polynomial, you can just assume that the matrix is diagonalizable, and whatever computation you do there will extend to all of GLM.
Okay, thank you, sir.
By Zariski sort of thing. Okay, so that's okay. So now we defined character of sigma, circle character of rho, as taking the character of sigma and substituting in it the weights for rho. So this works in a slightly more general setting. Suppose G is a sum of monomials. Actually, it doesn't even need to be symmetric in this case, but let's assume it's symmetric also. That's the only case we are interested in. And F is any symmetric polynomial. Then we can compute, let's say, in M variables. Then we can compute F circle G of X. Let's say these are mono.
Amri, are there coefficients in G or?
So the coefficients of G here are going to be non-negative integers. So I'm writing it as a sum of monomials
with
multiplicity.
Okay.
So we can think of this as a multiset.
So you are writing it as a sum of two x square. You are writing as x square plus x square, for example.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
So if you can write G like this, then you can imitate the earlier. Formula to write F circle G is just F, and then you substitute in place of the variables of F the monomials of which G is made up. That right? So this is a slight generalization where F is now allowed to be quite general, but again, there's this restriction on the number of variables, and G has to be symmetric polynomial with non-negative integer coefficients. And the total sum of those coefficients is the number of variables in F. Okay, so what we really, so the key to now defining plethysm in complete generality is to use power sum symmetric functions. So let me just remind you, pk of x1, x2, xn is just x1 raised to k plus dot, dot, dot plus xn raised to k. So, and you can also do this if you, so usually when we work with symmetric functions, we take the stable case, that is, there'll be symmetric functions in infinitely many variables. You can also define pk in infinitely many variables. But now if you do this, then what you'll see is that f circle pk is just, well, let's say evaluated at x, is f evaluated at x1 to the k, xn to the k. This is just using this formula up here, right? And on the other hand, what is pk circle f? So I'd have to assume that f is, you know, of the form, of this form where g is here. So f is of the form x raised to, let's say, nu j, j goes from 1 to something. Let's not get hung up on that. So sum over j x nu j. Then pk circle f of x would be, now I would take pk and in that I would substitute these things. So I would have x nu j raised to the power k, x nu 1 raised to the power k plus x nu 2 raised to the power k and so on, which is basically x1 to the power, x to the power k times nu 1 plus dot, 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 x to the power k times whatever. X to the power k times nu 1 plus x to the power k times nu 2 and so on. And what is this? This is also, if you now take f having this form, and if, you know, then this is also x to the power k times nu 1 plus x to the power k times. Okay, this is a very important calculation. So I hope it's clear to all of you.
Here the pk of x, the number of variables of pk of x depends on f.
So yeah, so the number that is, yeah, so maybe we have to take both to have n variables. Maybe f has to have, let's just take here, probably, yeah. So there's that issue with the number of variables. Let's just take this. Though maybe, yeah. So what I want to do is work with actually infinitely many variables. Okay, and if you work with infinitely many variables, this kind of confusion completely goes away. And
but then f has finitely many variables, then we cannot.
Okay, so let's just sort through this. So so suppose we are taking pk in n variables, then f here has to have n variables, right? And so maybe I need to take f of this form, j equals 1 to n. But this is a sort of a bad restriction. Okay, so this is what happens if you have finitely many variables. But now suppose I take infinitely many variables, okay, which means countably many variables. Then this pk is just x1 to the power k plus x2 to the power k plus dot dot. So it has countably infinitely many variables. And this is x1 to the power k, x2 to the power k dot dot dot, which is just this. And pk circle f, again makes sense, because now this f, it any non-zero symmetric function will either be constant or it will have countably infinitely many monomials in it. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Because there are infinitely many variables, to make it symmetric you have to have. So then this makes perfect sense in infinitely many variables. So a lot of confusion comes from using finitely many variables. So what we have...
Could we just do an, since you said that it is important, could we just do one example, please? PK, sure. PK of say symmetric or even PK of P2 or something like that. Okay. Even that, or PK of complete symmetric in two
variables
of degree 2. Yeah.
So what is PL? PL is x1 to the L plus x2 to the L plus dot, 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 right? So this is
infinitely many variables, right?
Yeah, infinitely many variables. So this is, now we have to take PK, and in place of the variables x1, x2, x3, we have to put x1 to the L, x2 to the L, dot, 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 right? So what is that? So that is x1 to the power L raised to the power k. And that is nothing but P subscript k. So does that help?
Let's do one with a complete symmetric polynomial of degree 2. Okay.
So let's do... P2 circle H2. So this calculation gets a bit messy, but okay, so what are we doing, right? So we're going to take, what are the monomials of H2? So H2 is X1 squared plus X1, X2. So you have to somehow enumerate all the maybe I'll write it like this. It is there are two kinds of variables here, summation xi squared, and then there's summation I less than j xi x2. And so what you have to do here is you have to take in P2, so this is like P2, and then you're going to substitute, you somehow got to enumerate these variables and substitute them. So maybe it's easier to do it the other way around. Anyway, we've seen that F circle PK is PK circle F. So we'll do H2 circle
PK. H2 is nothing but X1 square plus X1 X2 plus X2 square.
Now we're taking infinitely many variables. So it is X1
what
squared.
What 2 represent?
2 represents the degree.
Okay.
So this is the complete symmetric function of degree 2. So what you will do is, you will just take. So now in the place of these variables, you would substitute the monomials of x2. So xi will become xi squared. So you'll get xi to the power 4 plus summation I less than j xi squared x2. Okay, and soon I'm going to explain to you the most general way to calculate things. But it will be based on this, you have to agree to this identity that F circle PK is PK circle F.
Only true for PK, right?
Only for PK. Of course, PK circle PL also we did, and that's PKL. But okay, so let me write down the rules of the game here. So what we have is the following.
Amri, I have a question.
Yeah.
What does this previous one mean represent? Does it have a representation theoretic meaning?
PK doesn't have a nice representation theoretic interpretation.
No, not PK itself, but F of PK is equal to PK of F.
I do not know of a purely representation theoretic
meaning to that.
To me, this is just a way to get your foot in the door to start computing plethysmas.
Okay.
Or even to defining them formally.
Hmm.
So what we have is the following observations. One is that PK circle PL is PK times L. The second, which I just told you, is that F circle PK is PK circle F. And the third observation, which I didn't explicitly mention, but it's somehow here, that suppose I have F circle G, then that's, you know, into F you substitute the monomials of G. So now suppose I have two functions, F1 and F2, and I take F1 circle G and F2 circle G and multiply them, and I compare it with F1, F2 circle G, the answer will be the same, because what I'm doing is I'm, you know, just substituting the monomials of G into F1, into F2, or into F1, F2. So whether I first substitute and then multiply, or whether I multiply and then substitute, does not matter in this variable here. So what I'm saying is that the map which sends F to F circle G is an algebra homomorphism for each fixed G. Okay, so this is for all KL, this is for all K, and for every symmetric function. So these are three observations that come from this this calculation that we have done. All this right now, what I'm doing is kind of motivation and heuristic. Okay, so what now to work with plethysm formally is that we are going to treat these as axioms. Okay, and these axioms seem to hold when we are working with composition of polynomial representations. And these axioms end up being enough to define plethysm because of a beautiful fact from symmetric function theory. So if you take lambda to be a partition, so that's just a sequence of non-negative integers.
Amri, I am a little confused in these axioms. Huh. But didn't you want to define f of g, you wanted G or F to be of some form, right? I mean, with non-negative coefficient, etc.
Yeah. Now we needed that, but I want to get rid of that. Uh-huh. And so what I'm going to explain now is that with the help of these axioms, I can define F circle G for any symmetric functions F and G.
I see. Okay. Okay, thanks.
Amri sir, I have a question. So, morphism on what algebra? Algebra of all symmetric functions?
Algebra of all symmetric functions in infinitely many variables over your favorite field.
Okay,
maybe,
but again,
zero will be needed. Yeah.
About what Raghavan sir asked, they should be of the coefficients should be non-negative integers.
So for this calculation here, we needed that G should have coefficients which are non-negative integers. But now I'm going to define plethysm in more generality. So there we will be able to get rid of this condition that the coefficients of G are non-negative. Okay, so let me just go back to these slides and tell you the logical listing. So first approximation of plethysm is this, that your symmetric functions are actually characters of representation. Then, as Ramadas suggested, if you find out which representations they are characters of, and you compose those, and then you compute the character of that. Then we sort of work through how this will work, and in terms of the weights of those representations. And what we found is that we must substitute the monomials of character of rho into character of sigma. That is this character calculus expression here at the bottom of this page. And so that we can do even if F is not the character of representation. As long as F is any symmetric function, we can substitute the monomials of G into F. And because it's symmetric, the order in which you write those monomials does not matter. Okay, so that's the second approximation. Now, from these approximations, we have kind of collected three properties. You can maybe make many more properties you can find, but three we have isolated, and those are very helpful as axioms for plethysm. So now let's not call these axioms yet. I've just written down three properties which work in this context. Okay, so now just think of them as three properties which work when G is say has non-negative integers. Okay. And the reason that these power sum symmetric functions are useful is the following. So you take an integer partition lambda, and then you can define p lambda to just be the product I goes from 1 to n p lambda I. Okay, so this is a more general power sum symmetric function. And it's a well-known theorem that if you're in a field of characteristic 0, then p lambda, where lambda is an integer partition, is a basis of symmetric functions, of all symmetric functions. Okay, another way of looking at it is that the ring of symmetric functions is the free the polynomial algebra in P1. So let's say over C, then it's just okay, these two are equivalent because these things are really monomials of the variable P1, P2, and you're saying that the monomials form of basis. So now if you want to define something on all symmetric functions, then you can just define it on P1, P2, P3 and let some sort of algebraic, and then say it's an algebra homomorphism. And so that's going to be our strategy for defining plethysm. Is that okay? So I'll go on. So now this is how we come to the formal definition of symmetric functions. So now I will say let F and G be arbitrary symmetric. And so since F goes to F circle G is we want to define F circle G, right? So since this is an algebra homomorphism, it suffices to define PK circle G for any G. And because these now will generate the algebra of symmetric functions, the polynomial algebra. So in fact, no matter how you define these things, it will extend to a well-defined notion of plethysm for any F. So now how do we define PK circle G? Well, PK circle G we know is G circle PK. So we have sort of flipped it out, and now we know that in this argument G it is an algebra homomorphism. So let's exploit that. So if G is written in the P lambda basis, then G circle PK is just summation A lambda product P lambda I. So So in this way, you can define Plethysm for any symmetric functions f and g.
There is a k missing on the right side.
Sorry.
On the right side.
Yeah. Sorry.
But that is p. Okay.
I need one more step here. Thank you. I overlooked that. So p. You can in fact write this as a lambda p k lambda, where you just take the partition and scale it by q.
So can a lambda be negative?
No, lambda is a partition.
Lambda can be negative.
Oh, a lambda. Yeah. I thought you asked if k lambda. Yeah, so a lambda can be any element in your field of characteristics.
It cannot, g cannot be written as like positive sum of monomials.
No, g is any symmetric function. Any symmetric function can be written in the p lambda basis. So I want to remove that restriction that g is a positive sum of monomials. Okay. That's the whole point of this. Okay, so when g was a positive sum of monomials, we knew how to do this. Now I'm saying, what if it is not?
Okay.
Then I'm saying, well, g has this form, and now I'll use these axioms and define. So what we are saying is that there exists a well-defined, unique binary operation on symmetric functions which satisfies these three axioms.
Thanks.
And this is the way it is defined. So let's just try to now get more comfortable with this definition. It seems slightly convoluted in the sense you would have to expand both the symmetric functions involved in terms of power sum symmetric functions, and then you can do the computations. Okay, so I'll just do one example. These are exercises in McDonald's book. So let's say f and g are symmetric functions, and f is homogeneous of degree d. That means all the monomials in f are of degree d. And now I will ask, what is f circle minus g? This is not going to be minus f circle g, because we only are at least there's no reason why it should be, because our axiom said that it's an algebra homomorphism in the F argument. It didn't say anything about the G argument. So a good question is, what happens if I want to take this G and replace it by minus G? And the answer turns out to be a little more interesting than you would have thought. It's minus 1 raised to D, and then it's something omega appears, circle G. So this omega, let me remind you, this omega is an involution on symmetric functions. And it can be defined in various different ways. Most common ways to say that omega hk is ek. Hk here is the complete symmetric function. Ek is the elementary symmetric function. Omega ek is hk. And a very famous property of this omega is that omega s lambda is s lambda prime. So these are the Schur functions associated to partitions. And this is the conjugate partition. But in terms of power sum symmetric functions, what we have is omega pk is minus 1 raised to k minus 1 pk. So you can find these in my book, for example. These are fairly standard properties of omega. And if you take a general p lambda, it turns out that omega p lambda, well, using the fact that this omega actually is an algebra involution. So using the fact that it's an algebra involution, from pk you can generalize it to p lambda, and what if you work it out, you will find that it is minus 1 raised to size of lambda minus length of lambda times p lambda. Because if you just take minus 1 raised to k, then that will contribute to the size, and this minus 1 for each, you know, part will contribute to length. So this is the omega, and surprisingly, it appears when you try to compute this very simple plethysm f circle minus g. So shall we try to prove this? Okay, I don't hear a resounding yes, but I'll take silence for assent.
Yes.
Thanks. So we are going to try to prove. Oops, the d got. Okay. So g has degree d. We don't assume anything about f being homogeneous. So one common trick in proving all these kinds of identities.
Amri.
Yeah.
In the previous slide, you had F.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Thanks. You would have been caught late, sooner or later. Yeah. Okay. So a common trick in proving these kinds of identities is to say that I only need to prove it for F equals PK. Why is that? The point is that both sides of this identity are algebra homomorphisms in the argument F. The left hand side is obviously an algebra homomorphism in the argument F because it's a plethysm with something minus G. So that's just one of our axioms. The right hand side, well, you just need to check that also F goes to minus 1 raised to d omega f is an algebra homomorphism. So that's also because this omega itself is an algebra homomorphism. And f goes to...
But I'm a little confused. What is... See, you have assumed f is degree d.
Yeah.
So when you say both sides are algebra homomorphisms, what do you mean? I'm a little confused.
So that needs to be made a little more precise. I was trying to hand wave my way. So if you want to really write it down very carefully, then you need to expand F in the power sum basis. And then each of those monomial terms, P lambda, is homogeneous. And you show that if you prove it for PK, then it follows for F. But
instead of taking F, sir.
Yeah.
Instead of taking F equal to proving for only PK, can we prove it for G is equal to PK?
So it's an algebra homomorphism only in the F argument. So in a straightforward way to me, it seems like you can take F equals PK. It's not clear to me why you can take G equals PK. As you'll see later, even this is not true. It's not true that F circle G1 plus G2 is F circle G1 plus F circle G2. This is not true in general.
Okay.
So you have to be very careful when playing with the inner, this second guy.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so may I, Raghavan, will you allow me to?
Yes, go on, please. Yeah. Yeah.
So we'll take F equals PK. So what we're saying is, okay, let's look at the left-hand side. PK circle minus G. Well, we have an axiom which tells us how to deal with that. It is same as G circle PK, minus G circle PK. And now let's assume that G has, but it's an algebra homomorphism. This is just G minus G circle PK, right? But this is the same as minus 1 raised to d minus 1 raised to k, the degree of pk is k. Omega pk, because minus 1 raised to k, so what is omega pk? If you recall omega, where is it gone? Oh, omega, what happened to my omega? I thought I had defined omega somewhere.
It's in the next slide. 10th slide, page 10.
It seems to have disappeared, that slide. So omega pk is minus 1 raised to k minus 1 pk. So then if you have a minus there, then you get minus 1 raised to k omega pk. Circle. I again flipped it around, pk circle. So that, yeah. So but that's the right hand side when you take f equals p.
Here you're using the identity that fk of g is a g of, fk of pk, f of pk is pk of f.
Sorry?
Here you're using that, the thing that you said would be crucial for all calculations, namely that, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So that's used. I'm sorry, it looks like I inadvertently deleted my omega slide. So, the main thing to remember is this, and there's another one which we'll use. I'll recall it when we need it. Okay, so this turned out to be fairly straightforward using the fact that we only need to do calculations for pk, and once it works for pk, you can make it work for anything. So maybe just to address Raghavan's concern earlier, it doesn't make sense to, say that when you insist that something is homogeneous, then what does it mean to say that it is an algebra homomorphism? So every element can be written as a sum of homogeneous elements. And then those, you can just prove it for each homogeneous element. And then you can sort of reduce it to pk using the algebraic properties. Okay. So let's do a slightly trickier example, which is also an exercise in McDonald's. The saying that something is an exercise in McDonald's hardly narrows it down. Everything is an exercise in McDonald's. So here's, maybe I'll call it a theorem because it's kind of a little more subtle. So if f and g are symmetric, and this time I'll assume that g is homogeneous of degree d. Last time I'd assume that f is homogeneous of degree d. So this is another thing involving omega. Then omega of f circle g is, okay, this one turns out to be quite strange, omega to the power d circle f omega g. Now remember, this omega is an involution. So what this is saying is that if d is even, then you don't apply d to f, omega to f. And if d is odd, you apply omega to f. And to prove this, again, I'm going to just say that reduce to pk. And then I will look at left-hand side and right-hand side. So let's look at the left-hand side. Omega of pk circle g is equal to, so I'll use the, what axiom was that? Oops. Yeah, I'll use the axiom 2. Hey, what is happening, my pages are disappearing. Some sort of glitch here. Undo doesn't seem to recover them either. Okay. So what I wanted to prove is that omega of f circle g is omega df circle omega g. And so I'm going to take f equals pk. And so what I get is omega of pk circle g. Let's work this out. Well, I can say this is omega of g circle pk using the second axiom. And then let's take that g has this form summation a lambda p lambda. So I get omega of, summation a lambda p lambda. And then we have circle pk. And this becomes p lambda k. So what we get is summation a lambda. Now I'll use the fact that omega itself is an algebra homomorphism. And what I'll get is omega p lambda I times k. But so what have I done here? P lambda lethism pk is p lambda k times lambda, and then I've expanded that out as a product, and then I've applied omega. So but what is omega of p lambda I times k? So just remind you of a formula. Omega of p lambda is minus 1 raised to size of lambda minus length of lambda p lambda. So these p lambdas are eigenvectors for omega, and there's always a sign. So this is summation a lambda minus 1 raised to. So this size of lambda is the, here I'm assuming that g has degree d. Okay, so this d is the degree of g. So this lambda is going to be of size d. So I can write, instead of size of lambda, I can write d times d times, but then there's also this multiplication by k, but the length is the same. I hope you are still with me here.
Oh, length doesn't change. Huh? I mean, length multiplied by k.
Okay, so that's the
product is missing.
Yeah, maybe I'll write it like this: k times lambda. Then I don't have to write the product. Okay, and let's look at the. This is the left hand side. And let's look at the right hand side. So the right hand side was, recall, it was omega to the.
Amri.
Yeah.
You seem to be creating new layers, and that could explain the loss of the previous slides.
Oh. Yeah, maybe I've created a new layer. But it doesn't explain how do I get out of this. So the problem is that the Zoom controls are also on the same screen, and it's getting a bit confusing what I'm clicking on. So anyway, this first talk we'll get the hang of it. So let's see. So right hand side, right? So I need to take omega to the dpk and apply it to omega of g.
A non-mathematical question.
Yeah.
What software are you using to, what is this?
I'm using something called Zernal +++.
Is this free and downloadable?
Yes. One that you could consider is Stylus Labs Write. WRITE. So.
But you are writing with a stylus.
I'm writing with a stylus on a Wacom tablet.
Uh-huh, okay.
So in fact, I'll discuss this with you later. We should see what we can do about these things. So yeah, so this is the thing. And omega dpk circle omega g. And so let's just work this out. So what is omega dpk? So it's minus 1 to the power dk. So omega is minus 1 to the power k minus 1. So I should apply d times. So minus 1 to the power d times k minus 1. Yeah. Each time I apply omega, it's a power k minus 1. I do d times, it becomes d times k minus 1. And then we have circle omega g. And then I can flip these around. Omega g circle pk. And then I can expand this g. So I'll get a lambda, but then the omega goes inside p lambda circle pk. And this is minus 1 raised to dk minus 1. And then this omega p lambda, well, I know what that looks like. So that's minus 1 raised to size of lambda. Now that's just b minus length of lambda. And then it's p lambda times p, maybe I'll write it as k times lambda. The partition, all its parts are scaled by k. Okay, so so that is summation a lambda, and then I get d times k minus 1 plus d. So that's minus 1 raised to dk minus l lambda p k lambda. And let's see if this matches with what we had earlier. Yes, so it is summation a lambda minus 1 dk minus l lambda. So that proves this identity here. Okay, so so that's another example illustrating how we work with plethysms. And I want to see something weird happened when I tried to add a page. Okay, so let me try to do this very slowly again. Oh, I haven't created a new layer. Okay, I got a new page, but okay, I have two new pages now. Okay, so fine. So that we've now, so far, what have we done?
The first page was the page 13 background layer.
Okay. Anyway, let's just I tried to see that, but there are two layers now, but neither of them has everything I want. Okay, so here's another. So what we did is we looked at f of minus g. So that was very nice in terms of omega. What about f? I'm switching between notations. So suppose we have f circle g1 plus g2. I already warned you that this is not going to be f circle g1 plus x f circle g2. So what is this going to be? So, okay, and the reason I want to do this is it leads to another very interesting thing in symmetric functions, which is called the co-product structure on symmetric functions, which together with the product structure and so on gives the ring of symmetric functions the structure of a Hopf algebra. But you don't need to know what Hopf algebras or anything is. I'll try to explain this in very elementary terms. So I'll just, so far I've avoided using any notation for symmetric functions, but I think now I have to do it. So lambda x is going to denote symmetric functions in variables x1, x2, dot, 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 countably many variables with name x. And I'll also use lambda y to denote symmetric functions in variables y1, y2, and so on. And now why am I doing all this? Because I'll want some functions in two sets of variables, lambda x, y. So these will be sort of functions in variables x and y, but symmetric only in each set of variables. Symmetry amongst x variables and y variables, but not across. So you cannot interchange an x variable with a y variable. Okay, so this seems, you know, why can I do this in infinitely many variables and so on? A nice way to resolve all those questions is to notice the following, I can also define it like this. So if you take symmetric functions in x and tensor it with symmetric functions in y, you get this ring xy. And how does this work? You have your symmetric function f, you have a symmetric function g, you take it to fx multiplied by gy. Okay, so this is this new ring that I've introduced of symmetric functions in two types of variables is just a twofold tensor product of the ring of symmetric functions with itself. Okay, here this x and y are just, you know, this is the same ring, but I have just found it convenient to distinguish between the variables here and the variables here. And now once you realize this, what you have is defined. This is going to be what is called a co-product. I'll explain why it's called a co-product in a minute. A function from lambda x to lambda x semicolon y by, maybe I need to go to the next page. Let me just copy this thing and take it along. Delta of f. Now I have a function in one set of variables. How can I make it a function in two sets of variables? Well, I'll just plug in those variables. So I'll say f of x1, y1, x2, y2, and so on. Okay, I could have said x1, x2, y1, y2, and so on. It's all symmetric. It doesn't matter in which order I put it in. I just need to make sure that I put in all the x variables and all the y variables. So this is the co-product structure on symmetric functions. I'm just calling it that. I'll explain why it is called that in a minute. But let's compute some examples of this, okay, just to make ourselves comfortable with this. So what is delta pk? So any guesses? So it is just, you know, x1 raised to k plus y1 raised to k plus blah, blah, blah. x2 raised to k plus y2 raised to k. Now, okay, fine. So that's what it is. But I want to make this identification with lambda x tensor lambda y. So what is this in there? So I claim that this is nothing but pk tensor 1 plus 1 tensor. What is pk? Oops, tensor 1? It is a function in the variables x and y where only the x variables appear. Right? So if you have, let's go back to the definition of this thing, the isomorphism between lambda x tensor lambda y and lambda x y. So if I take g to be the function 1, the constant function 1, then I'm just taking f to fx. So if I can separate my this function here separates into two parts. One is pkx and the other is pky. This pkx corresponds to pk tensor 1 because only the x variables appear, and this pky is 1 tensor pk.
Sir, in above also it is f tensor 1 and 1 tensor f.
Sorry?
In the above definition, f of x, the delta of f of x comma y?
No, it is defined in terms of substitution. So
it is not 1 tensor f plus f tensor y.
So I'm defining this as an element of lambda x semicolon y. And then I'm using the isomorphism between lambda x semicolon y and lambda x tensor lambda x. So this is not in general. Let me do a second example. You'll see that this is cannot always be 1 tensor f plus f tensor 1. That property is special to pks. Okay? So let's do, for example, maybe I'll give this as an exercise, but lambda hk, delta hk is going to be sum r plus s equals k hr tensor hs. And delta ek also is going to be r plus s equals k ER tensor ES. So it is not at all true that this kind of formula holds for anything, huh? And you can, if you are somewhat more well versed in symmetric functions, you can try this one. And this one is very beautiful. It turns out to involve Littlewood-Richardson coefficients. Okay, so this is the, maybe I'll mark these as exercises. So the first two are relative.
Amri, the last one is true because you've just defined it as multiplication of symmetric functions. Isn't that true?
Yeah, so I'll come to that. I was just going to come to that. So I haven't really explained why it's called co-multiplication. It's the dual of multiplication of symmetric functions. Oh, this is terrible. This thing is malfunctioning like anything. I wonder if it is. Okay, here's my new page anyway. I don't know what happened to my old pages. Okay. So anyway, I've not lost this page. Okay, so let's go on. So firstly, let me come to inner products to understand this. They are important. So this lambda x has an inner product. And this inner product is defined in many ways. One of the ways of defining this inner product is that the Schur functions form an orthonormal basis. But for us, the most useful way to define this inner product is in terms of power sum symmetric functions. And it is this, 1 over z lambda delta lambda. So what we're saying is that the power sum symmetric functions also form an orthogonal basis, but not orthonormal. And this factor z lambda in the denominator is the number of elements in Sn which commute with a permutation whose cycle type is lambda. So order of centralizer of a permutation with cycle type. So it's some you know, combinatorial invariant. And so now because of this,
which Sn? So this z lambda, this is in which Sn? What is that n?
So if lambda is a partition of n, then so if you have any permutation, then its cycle type will be a partition of the n of which it is a permutation.
Okay. Yeah.
So if lambda is a partition of n, then this has to be done in Sn.
Right.
Does it also proves that z lambda is equal to z mu?
No. We are saying if lambda is mu, is nu, then you can put either z lambda or z mu. If they are different, Also, you can put either of them, but then this thing is zero, so it doesn't matter which one you put.
Thank you.
How about this? Okay, that was a joke. But you could take square root of z lambda times z nu, then that would be clearly symmetric. So this guy, each of these tensor factors has an inner product. So this also inherits an inner product. So what this lets us do is it lets us identify these spaces with their duals. Okay, and now the reason why I'm calling this a co-product and what Raghavan was saying, that delta F G tensor H is the same as, so this is an inner product in the tensor lambda, tensor lambda, and here is an inner product in lambda for all symmetric functions F G H. And how do we prove this? Well, the point is, firstly, you notice that delta is an algebra homomorphism. Why is that? It's kind of because of the way we defined it. See, we just substituted the variables inside. So it remains an algebra homomorphism in the argument F. So delta is an algebra homomorphism. So I can prove it. F equals pk. I can also take G and H to be I can take these to be basis elements. So here I will take P lambda tensor P mu. Well, what is this? Okay, I can just check it against a basis. So here basis given by P lambda tensor P mu. So by definition, this is PK tensor 1 plus 1 tensor PK, and then inner product against P lambda tensor P mu. But this inner product on the tensor is the product of the inner products on the tensor factors. And here I have some pure tensors. So this is inner product of PK with lambda multiplied by inner product of 1 with P mu. So this is the same as 1 over K minus 1 factorial. That is the centralizer Z of K is 1 over K minus 1 factorial. It doesn't matter. It's not important. Delta of K, whether the partition with one part K is equal to lambda. And this one is actually P0. So 0 mu plus delta 0 lambda delta K. Okay, so this is the left hand side. And let's see what happens to the right hand side. So maybe I'll just, so the right hand side, I'm taking PK, inner product, P lambda multiplied by P mu, which is the same as delta 1 over K minus 1 factorial delta K. And P lambda tensor P mu, it's again a power sum symmetric function corresponding to the partition whose parts are the union of the parts of lambda and the parts of mu. So I'll just call it lambda union. Okay, so that's what it is. And then you just have to check that this expression here is the same as this expression. So basically, how can lambda union, so let's just copy this thing. This is going to be tricky to copy. Okay, so let's copy this and go down to the next page. And paste it. So I want to know if this is the same, right? So this can be one if and only if lambda union mu has only one part, which is k, which can only happen if either this is trivial and that is singleton k, or mu is trivial and lambda is singleton k. But that's the same as what's happening here. Okay, it's saying that lambda is singleton k and mu is trivial, and this is saying that lambda is trivial and mu is singleton k. So this is true. So what we've proved is that delta f g tensor h is f comma g tensor h. So what this meaning is that this delta from wedge x to lambda x to lambda x tensor lambda x, it induces a dual star from lambda x tensor lambda x to lambda x. And this delta star, this identity is saying that delta star is nothing but the multiplication map. M from lambda x tensor lambda x to lambda x. So this delta is the dual under this inner product on symmetric functions of the multiplication. Okay, so much for delta. And what does all this have to do with plethysm? So what it has to do with plethysm is the following theorem. F circle G1 plus G2 is M applied to delta F circle G1 tensor G2. So there's some stuff happening here. This plethysm here is, plethysm is from this. It's a binary operation on symmetric functions, but you can also apply plethysm to symmetric functions in pair of variables by just defining on pure tensors plethysm of F1 tensor F2 circle G1 tensor G2 to be plethysm of F1 circle G1 and plethysm of F2 and G2. So this gives a plethysm on, this is a plethysm on lambda xy. Okay, so this is getting a bit intricate here, that now we have to have plethysm on the tensor of symmetric functions with themselves. And that is what is appearing on the right hand side of this formula. So what this will give you is it will give you a symmetric function in the two sets of variables, but then you can apply the multiplication map and resolve it into a symmetric function in one set of variables. So this is the theorem. And as you can guess, I'm sorry, there's a lot of noise outside. But maybe I'll just give me a second, I'll close the window. It's still a bit noisy, but I hope I can be heard. Can I be heard?
Yeah.
Yes, loud and clear.
Okay. There's a lot of noise. There's a truck doing something on the road. So here we go. So let's just prove this, and that will be the last thing. I'm sorry, it's kind of 12:30 almost. So again, as usual, both sides are homomorphisms in F. So I'll just take F equals PK. And then I have PK circle G1 plus G2. Well, that's G1 plus G2 circle PK. And that's G1 circle PK plus G2 circle PK. And now this is the left hand side. And the right hand side is pi of delta PK circle G1 tensor G2. And now you'll see how this plethysm on the tensors goes. So this is pi of PK tensor 1 plus 1 tensor PK. And this thing has to be taken with G1 tensor G2. So now I will take, it is a sum of two things. So this is pi of, so PK tensor 1 circle G1 tensor G2 is PK circle G1 tensor 1 circle G2. And the second term becomes 1 circle G1 tensor PK circle G2. Now remember that this 1 is nothing but P0. And remember, P0 plethysm anything is PK times 0, it's P0. P0 plethysm anything is P0. So it just kills everybody. So I get pi of, and P1 circle anything is that thing itself. So this is G1 tensor 1 plus 1 tensor. Sorry, this was PK, not P1. PK, I'm sorry. So this is PK circle G1 tensor 1 plus 1 tensor PK circle G2. But then when I multiply, then this PK circle 1 tensor 1 just becomes PK circle 1 circle G1, and this becomes PK circle G2, which is the same as this guy, right? This and this are the same. So that proves this theorem here. And maybe with this, I will stop. I hope this has just given you some familiarity with plethysm, how to